So I think since the Middle Ages, the way I see it, there have been sort of three great phases of building in Britain. There was the sort of classicism of the 18th century, there was the eclecticism of the 19th century, of the Industrial Revolution, and then there was the modernism of the welfare state.
And, of course, tonight my subject is the third of these periods. Now, I put on the screen here as my first slide something that illustrates the big contrast between those last two periods, the eclecticism of the Industrial Revolution and the modernism of the welfare state. Because faced by new types of building from the mid-19th century, there were two possible aesthetic responses. Either architects made utilitarian structures, such as railway stations, fit traditional aesthetics, or they had to seek to try and change the criteria of beauty to suit the demands of technology. And so I'm illustrating that with the Isochron building that I mentioned in my last lecture on the left-hand side, and obviously St. Pancras Chambers on the right-hand side. So the Victorians did the first of those. It made utilitarian structures fit traditional aesthetics, and the modernists did the second, change the criteria of beauty to suit the demands of technology. We can put this in another way. Either beauty lies in the eye of the beholder, or beauty is inherent to the building itself. So the building, the Victorians argued for extrinsic beauty. In other words, that beauty came from the associations that came from the various styles of architecture which they plundered for their inspiration, while the modernists argued for intrinsic beauty. In other words, that the structures themselves contained inherent properties that were beautiful. Beauty was to express the function of a building and its structure. And in a sense, in this way, the modernists invented a new rule of design. Architecture as art was replaced by architecture of service, architecture of utility, architecture of function. And architecture, they argued, without style, where the form was determined solely by the function. Modernism seemed like this, certainly as far as the proponents of it were concerned, was not a style at all. It was, if you like, the Holy Grail, the final chapter, the solution to the dilemma of style, which I talked about two lectures ago, which the Victorians faced, which is what was the appropriate language to build in for the modern age. Now, until about 10 years ago, historians, people like Nicholas Pevsner, Sir John Summerson, believed that modernism, as you see it here on the left-hand side, was the inevitable result of progress, the logical conclusion of the development of architectural styles since the 18th century. But these people very much wrote in the aftermath of the Second World War, a war which effectively collectivized society. To win the war, every aspect of national life had been brought under the control of the state. And this is a really important point because people miss the point sometimes that it was necessary for the British state to nationalize things in a far greater sense than the Nazis ever did in Germany. The lesson seemed to be from the Second World War that with the tools of a new style of architecture, the state could bring a new and better world for the population of Britain. And this forward-looking dynamic was not only built on the streets, it was enshrined in the history books. Now, of course, not everyone at the time saw this new modernist utopia as a positive force. I pulled off my bookshelf the other day this book. Some of you may have got it at home. It's Lord Clark's book, Civilization, which he rather reluctantly published in 1969. It was the accompaniment to the now famous television series of the same name. But looking through that book, it's apparent that for him, civilization stopped in 1914. Well, perhaps not stopped, but that after 1914, we entered a phase which he describes as, and I quote, the era in which we are now living. It was an era in which he felt profoundly uncomfortable. Phrases appear in the introduction to the book, such as, we have no idea where we are going, and I am completely baffled by what is taking place today. And these phrases by the foremost cultural commentator of the 1960s, I think epitomise an age in which he saw the computer as a tool with which a minority could keep the majority in subjection. And he summed it all up, saying in the conclusion, and I quote now, one must concede that the future of civilization does not look very bright. One might be optimistic, he wrote, but one can't be exactly joyful about the prospect in front of us. This lack of joy is entirely understandable if you take as your starting point that civilization rests on the shoulders of individual geniuses. And this was, in fact, the theme of Clark's programme and the theme of his book. And I think in 1969, it must have seemed at the very least questionable whether this was true any longer and whether it could ever be true ever again. Where was the genius in post-war England? Safely insulated at Saltwood Castle, his family home in Kent, this perhaps hardly mattered to Kenneth Clark. But as he got off the train at Waterloo Station in 1969, he would have been confronted with the hard facts that after the Second World War, architecture in Britain had been nationalised. As everything else had been nationalised, architecture had been nationalised. The state had taken over the patronage of architecture. Very, very few private individuals built in the prevailing modernist style. It was the state, it was local government, it was central government, it was the universities, it was the post office, it was the railways. These people were the patrons of the age, not the great geniuses which Kenneth Clark had pointed to in his great series. Not only this, but the immediate post-war years were a period of economic crisis and rationing, and so buildings had to be cheap. Now, cheap is a pejorative word, perhaps, and so I'm going to not use it. I'm going to use the word lean. I think it is actually a better and more descriptive word, because what this was about was building the strongest possible structures with the smallest possible quantity of materials. So I'm just going to just explain what I mean for a moment. So let's take some of the famous buildings of the 1950s. This is a school just around the corner from me, where I live in Norfolk, built by Alison and Peter Smithson in 1949 to 1954. Hunstanton School, extraordinary building. It's grade one listed. It was the result of a competition. The Smithsons didn't even visit the site before putting this up, because this was an academic essay in producing a modernist building. They had to justify, in building this building, every tiny inch of steel. And as a result, it was engineered extremely sparsely. So this classic modernist building, whilst expressive of its style, was also expressive of the economic crisis. So this this engineering, this sparse engineering, this lean engineering, was all entirely experimental. And what that means is that many of the buildings which we really ought to be discussing this evening are no longer with us, because they were experimental and they've fared very badly. And this school, for instance, has fared incredibly badly. Because it was an experimental building, the Smithsons didn't realise that if you build a structure like that in a continuous welded steel frame, and it's built in Hunstanton, which is actually a very sunny place, the frame will expand and contract, which is exactly what it did, smashing all the glass. So these buildings have fared very badly. But let me just show you a couple, just to show what I mean. So this is another one. This is Geoffrey Chaucer School. It's actually a grade 2 listed building. It's in Harper Street in SE1 in London. Designed by Chamberlain, Powell and Bond, the same architects who designed the Barbican Centre. Opened in 1958. And what you're looking at is the extraordinary pentagonal assembly hall and the gymnasium, which actually is just off the slide. This building was constructed pushing the technical capabilities of the materials used to their very, very limits. A design never before used or even contemplated in a school. As I say, these structures were experimental, and I think that thanks to changing attitudes to education and often very poor maintenance, this building, as well as the Smithton High School, has had a very difficult history. Of course, some of the structures, these structures only failed later on, failed right from the beginning. This is the wonderful, fabulous building, the Metropolitan Cathedral of Christ the King in Liverpool, the Roman Catholic Cathedral, designed by Sir Frederick Gibberd in 1967. And here, the rainwater drainage systems on the roof of the central pavilion have caused these big struts here to have endless difficult problems. The cladding has broken off, and it's been a real headache from the beginning. Here's another one. Some of you may recognise this. It's another London building. This is the Commonwealth Institute. This is another one of those extraordinary pentagonal roofs. Hyperbolic paralloid, it's called, is a technical term. If you can remember that, I'll test you in September, see if you can remember it. This was built by RMJM in 1962 and has also had terrible problems sort of keeping the water out. So these very experimental buildings, very lean buildings, built in the immediate aftermath of the Second World War, have fared quite badly. But of course, some of them have fared much better, and unlike, I think, the three that I've just shown you, have been much more popular. I wonder what Kenneth Clark thought of the Royal Festival Hall, which I think very unusually for a modernist building is genuinely popular with the public. People really like the Festival Hall. The commissioning architect of the Festival of Britain was Hugh Casson, and he appointed Leslie Martin, Robert Matthew and Peter Morrow from the London County Council's architect department to design it. It was finished in 1951. It doesn't look like that anymore, because in 1961-4, the whole of the riverside facade was altered. And this is, I think, an extremely important point that I want to draw your attention to this evening. The original design was actually quite playful. It was quite light-hearted. And in many ways, it broke some of the rules of modernism. These sort of very light-hearted pieces here, the way this drops down in a way that clearly it's not being supported by any structure. And so when it was refaced in the 1960s, it was given a much more sort of modernist feel. And so if you look at the top slide, that is actually what it looks like today. After refacing, and as you can see, it's really has a really quite a different look, a much more stripped back look, a much more austere look, much more sort of a structurally expressive look than what it originally actually had. And it was this look at the bottom, the original look, that led to a reaction from the new generation of young architects, all of whom were commissioned by government, and all of whom hated the frippery, what they saw as the decoration, the lack of seriousness behind the buildings of the Festival of Britain. And the anger, and it almost was anger that they felt, turned to the style of architecture that we generally today call brutalism. So take this building here, an icon of modernism, I think icon of brutalism. This is the engineering building in the University of Leicester by James Stirling, built in 1959 to 1963. One of the most influential modernist buildings in the world. Uncompromisingly brutalist, I would say. It would look much more at home in Moscow, perhaps, than it does in Leicester. Park Hill Flats, I'm a great champion of this building. I think it's an amazing building. In Sheffield, by Jack Lynn and Ivor Smith, completed in 1961. This represented, in many ways, the triumph of the construction, or the attempt at a construction of a new Jerusalem. Here is a local authority rehousing its inhabitants in a building that was designed to solve all their problems. The solution to people's wants and desires, a building provided by the state to allow people to be free inside. Vast, ugly, concrete and collapsing, it still dominates Sheffield. It's probably amongst the most, if not the most, controversial listed building in the country. And then let's move on back to London, and we're going to talk about this right at the end of my lecture this evening, the South Bank. Also devised by the London County Council architects. These are all architects working for the government, as I said before. This comprising the Purcell Room, the Haywood Gallery, no windows, and a door deliberately hidden away, because they didn't want to have any hierarchy in buildings. They wanted to get away from the old pre-war notion of a building with hierarchy. So the hierarchy is banished. You can't really tell where to get in. You can't really tell where to look out. And these buildings, of course, were designed to contain objects to enhance and delight the senses. Next door, we have the National Theatre by Sir Dennis Lasdon. I think a much better building in its monolithic grandeur. But, of course, in its composition, it is still utterly brutal. Now, these individual commissions that I've been talking about should be seen in a wider context. And that context is the destruction of some of the most beautiful medieval and Georgian towns in England, places like Plymouth, Nottingham, Leicester, Derby, etc. And the story, the sort of parallel story of this starts in the middle of the war with a big burst of optimism. The father of it all is Lord Reith, and in response to the Nazi bombing of London and Plymouth, he commissioned Lord Abercrombie, the greatest planner of his day, to draw up a plan for the reconstruction of London and the reconstruction of Plymouth. And this plan triggered a whole series of plans for almost every single major town in England. But of these early plans, only one was actually built, and that was at Plymouth. And Plymouth today encapsulates the dream that was dreamt in the middle of the Second World War by planners and architects. This is the city devoted to two things, the department store and the motor car. And you can see these big blocks of department stores here, and the big road that goes through the middle. I mean, beautifully planned, immaculately planned, beautifully executed, but with a very, very clear vision of what they were trying to achieve. But as I say, Plymouth was actually the only one to be rebuilt after the Second World War. What happened to the other plans? Well, the answer is, as I've already hinted, there was a serious shortage of building materials. Sir Stafford Cripps instituted massive budget cuts in 1947, stopping public building, and it was only finally in 1954, when the building licensing system was eventually abandoned, that a building boom began. And when that started, the Tory government, as it was then, unleashed a whole series of major road and city centre improvement schemes. They were designed generally by borough engineers. Again, my point about the nationalisation of architecture. And it was them who did what I consider the terrible, terrible damage that took place in our cities. This is Birmingham. Obviously, Birmingham, the classic example of what happened, and one of the first, with these huge sweeping roads with offices all around ploughing through the centre of the city. It was possible for the cities to do this because a city like Birmingham actually owned all the land in the centre of the city. The interesting thing, I think, is that many of these ideas that were implemented after 1945 were actually things that had been thought up in the 1930s. And in fact, I think many of these schemes would have actually been put into place in the 1930s if the political will and money and motivation had been there. And if you remember in my last lecture, those of you who are here, I spent a lot of time talking about the motor car and the impact of the motor car. And I think what would have happened if the war hadn't intervened was that it would have led to that earlier. So I don't think we should have been surprised. Just to give you an example, my favourite example of what happened to historic cities is Bristol, the famous example of Queen's Square, the greatest Georgian square outside Bath and London here. And what do they do in 1954? They put a motorway straight through the middle of it, diagonally. Now, thank goodness, 2 years ago, 3 years ago, the motorway was taken out and the square was put back. But this illustrates the extraordinary sense of confidence that gripped a generation of town councillors. This was the gung-ho spirit of the D-Day landings. It couldn't be anything else when you see how brutal it was on these historic cities. But in 1973, this whole brutal process came to a grinding halt. Spiralling inflation meant a collapse in public finances, and in the background was massive public protest. Here is a picture of the protests trying to save Covent Garden in the centre of London. 1975 was the European Year of Conservation, but I think most importantly of all, there was, by the mid-1970s, a horrible realisation that the predictions of the early 1960s had not come to pass. In the 1960s, they believed that the rapid population growth that had been seen immediately after the war would continue. They believed that car growth, which had trebled immediately after the war, would continue at a similar rate. And in both predictions, they were wrong. During the 1970s, as this realization dawned, public expenditure moved away from the city centres, thank goodness, and moved to the motorways in the countryside, and culminating in the building of the M25. So, this was an environment fundamentally different from that of the old Europe, whose civilization had been so eloquently chronicled in Kenneth Clark's series that I started off with. This was a world where, in the realms of architecture at any rate, the state was now the patron, and the architects were all too often faceless and angry men intent on sweeping away the buildings that had come before. Buildings that represented an old social order which the new politics in the new world wanted to replace. Perhaps in the matter of fine art, the area in which Kenneth Clark excelled, the signs were not as strong, although his last programme stopped before the First World War and he didn't examine contemporary art. But I think just as the state captured the patronage of architecture in England, so it moved centre stage to capture the patronage of fine art. And this is very relevant to what I'm going to say, and so I'm just going to take a moment to talk about fine art, because the balance between artists and museums fundamentally shifted in America in the 1930s. The Museum of Modern Art in New York opened in 1929, and for the first time, it approached living artists and gave them equivalent status with dead ones. And so, works of art like this suddenly were put on show. And so the 1960s saw traditional boundaries dissolved as art moved off the pedestal and out of the frame into the gallery spaces. Art was now all too often an installation, and it wasn't commissioned by private patrons, but it was commissioned by the curators of art museums. Artists themselves, I think, were disconcerted by this change. The massive audiences that patronage of public institutions brought were obviously very welcomed, but I think artists themselves disliked the shift away from being having the patronage being an individual to the patronage being institutions. As usual, it took change to take a little bit longer to come to Britain. But the moment that the British public realised that this change had taken place was the purchase by the Tate Gallery of a work of art called Equivalent Eight by Carl Andre in 1966. Some of you may remember it. It became known as the Pile of Bricks. 120 fire bricks arranged in a rectangular formation. This was a direct challenge to people's perception of what art was. It was also a challenge to what the role of a publicly funded institution was in directing and leading public taste. Well, you will probably all remember what public taste thought about this. This is a builder saying, the repose and calm of this work of art reflects the simplicity and restraint of my earlier period. The symbolism remains personal and eludes exact interpretation. Or there was this a jokey thing here. Why pay Tate Gallery price £4,000, art price £500 before VAT, a pile of bricks in the window? And perhaps more hostile, what a load of rubbish. So, there was this beginning of a gulf between artists and the public. And I'm going to come back at the end of my lecture this evening to talk about that gulf, because the gulf did not only appear in the museum, it appeared in the streets, because the same gulf developed between architects and the public. So just as county councils, town councils, and central government became the patrons of architecture, so institutions like the Tate Gallery became the bodies that shaped taste in contemporary art more than any other. So the state, for the first time, began to replace the old structures of individualistic artistic patronage after the Second World War. And that's why, in many ways, museums, I think, produce a very useful illustration of some of the leading architectural concerns of the age. And as I said at the beginning, we happen tonight to be sitting in a modernist museum. And I thought we might just take this as an example, just for a few minutes, of what I have been talking about. In the 5 months between Christmas 1976 and Easter 1977, three major modernist museum buildings were opened. On the 2nd of December 1976, the Queen opened this building here, the new Museum of London. Gleaming white tiles lying in slices upon the grim brownness of the Barbican podium brickwork, this is what greeted 750,000 visitors who rushed to see it. 2 months later, on the 2nd of February 1977, the Georges Pompidou Centre in Paris opened to the public. In its first year, 6.5 million visitors flooded through the famous building designed by Richard Rogers and partners. And on the 19th of April 1977, the Yale Centre for British Art in New Haven in America opened, designed by Louis Kahn of Philadelphia, a building of austere concrete with panels of dull pewter finish stainless steel, punctuated by plate glass windows, and inside panels of wood. Each of those three museums I've just shown you, I think, challenged the conventional image of a museum as a temple of learning laden with gravitas and tradition. And each of these was modernism's attempt to address the vexed question of what a 20th century museum should actually look like. Because after the Second World War, I think museum directors and the state itself began searching for a way of creating a museum without being bound by the whole 19th century vision of a museum, which was the accepted environment for showing works of art. Now, most of the important developments in museum design had actually taken place in America. From 1900 up until the Second World War, this is where it happened, because, of course, the majority of the great European collections had already got museums, and it was the Americans who were building new ones. And so, you have the Corcoran Gallery of Art in Washington. This is built, actually, in 1859. You then have, in New York, the Pierpont Morgan, opened in 1906, the Frick in New York, I haven't got a picture of that, in 1919. In Washington, the Phillips Gallery of 1921, the Freer, 1923. And in 1936, you get Andrew Mellon's National Gallery in Washington. What is notable about all of these is they are all built in classical styles. They all draw from the European tradition of building a museum as a temple to the arts. But what changed the game was the building of Frank Lloyd Wright's Guggenheim Museum in New York, designed in 1943 and built in 56 to 59. You know, obviously it's that bit, it's not those two bits there. That's the Guggenheim there, just so you know. Many of you will have been there, I guess. This was a modernist building uncompromisingly, and it has this astonishing sculptural external form with these spiral galleries. Oops, sorry. The spiral, with its spiral galleries. And it was hugely, hugely influential. We see the influence of this spiral again and again in modern museum design. But I think that when we look at what was built in Britain, there were essentially two types of modernist museum. There were two types of modernist building. And I'm just using museums as an example here, as I say, because I can't deal with everything. And those two types are assertive and reticent. The assertive buildings belong to a much more international school of brutalist modern architecture, whilst the reticent ones are a much more homegrown product. The assertive modernist buildings tended to be dramatic, sculptural, and often aggressive. I think you've got one on the screen there. They're usually physically very big, or they look big, and they all take their cue from the Guggenheim. So, typical of this is our friend the Hayward Gallery, already talked about it, the ultimate gallery macho. Squat, muscular, nestled amongst its equally brutalist neighbours. A much less well-known example, and I don't often stray outside England, but I'm just going to go to the Ulster Museum. This is by Francis Pym, to a design of 1963, but completed in 1971. Aggressive concrete mass, again, conceived around a central spiral, the central void. Some of you may have been to UEA, University of East Anglia, to see this. This is the Sainsbury Centre, Norman Foster and Associates, 1978, a bit like a sort of aircraft hangar. Huge scale, a bit like the Pompidou Centre itself, another assertive building. So that's our first school of modernist buildings, the assertive school. Contrasting with the macho of the assertive modernist museums and galleries is my second category, the reticent ones. And these, I think, are a much more indigenous product and ignore the need or the desire, the craving to be seen as European masterpieces. They have an English quality of sensitivity to their surroundings, and they often compose in quite a picturesque way. So in view of these, what have we got here? Well, there are quite a few university galleries built in the 1960s. This is the Christ Church Gallery, Christ Church Gallery, Oxford, by Powell and Moyer, the same people who built the museum we're in today. Very reticent, very elegant museum. In 1978, we get the British Library, the largest and I think most expression, complex expression of the reticent type of modernism. Although it was, was modified a little bit later with some postmodern detailing, it very modestly, I think, and neatly sits on the Euston Road. My photograph makes it look more brutalist than it feels. As you know, when you're on the Euston Road, it doesn't feel like an assertive building. It feels very reticent. The architect, Colin St. John Wilson, wrote in his book about the design and construction of the library that assertive modernist buildings, and I quote, fail to take account of the human, psychological, and symbolic elements that are in play in all of us. And that his building and the school of reticent modernist architecture to which it belonged had the overriding conviction that, and I quote again, inspiration must spring from a rigorous, factual appreciation of the required conditions and not the imposition of preconceived forms and ideas upon the real desires and necessities at issue. His building, I think, was to adopt organic forms that are more responsive to the growth of the growth of the city. And, of course, the Museum of London, designed in the late 1960s and completed after an 11-year construction period in 1976, is a reticent building, and I'll say a little bit more about that in a moment. And my last example, and this is one of my favourite modernist museum buildings, I think, anywhere in the world, is, does anyone know where that is? Yeah, Glasgow, the Burrell Collection by Barry Gasson, opened in 1982, finally. Designed in 1971 and opened in 1982. And I think he's the sort of apogee of the reticent building nestled in the gardens amongst the trees here. It was only really in the 1990s that we see a decline of modernist solutions to new buildings. One of the principal proponents of the sort of next generation of postmodern architects, of course, was James Stirling. And his work begins consciously to look backwards again, to abandon the forward-looking approach of modernism. So his Stuttgart Gallery, which is often characterised as one of the great galleries of Europe of the 20th century, he did build in England. He built the Claw Gallery at Tate, what's now called Tate Britain. I'm not sure how successful that building is. I think it's quite a difficult brief. And of course, the other one is the Venturi extension to the National Gallery, which also starts to use, again, historical references rather than just being a modernist building. But just very quickly, I just want to return to the building that we are in now, the Museum of London. Because here there was a debate, the Corporation of London had a debate about who should be the designer of the building. There was a competition, and Powell and Moyer, who we've seen before at Christchurch, won. They were the designers of this very fine building, recently listed, the Chichester Festival Theatre, and their last work, which you will know, was... Oh, no, sorry, that was not their last work. They designed the Skylon at the Festival of Britain, which you see there. Famous, wonderful building, or structure, perhaps one should say. And the last building, which you might know, is the Queen Elizabeth Conference Centre in Parliament Square. And so Powell and Moyer, obviously this was a post-Museum of London, but the other examples I've shown you there were either contemporary or before the museum. They went to America, they went to Mexico to look at museums, and of course they went to the Guggenheim, where they saw the spiral. And the Museum of London is actually designed on the principle of a spiral, influenced by the Guggenheim. And actually yesterday I was giving a lecture at the National Army Museum in Chelsea, and I'd already written this lecture, actually, so I didn't put it in, but as I walked around it, I realised that it also was based on the Guggenheim spiral. And so that was the inspiration of the for the Museum of London. But there was a problem. There was a problem right from the start, which was the site was a very, very difficult one, because the ironmonger's hall was in the middle of it. Now, those of you who walked here will be very aware that this poor little building is completely surrounded by the ironmonger's hall. How on earth, when the whole of the rest of the Barbican area was completely flattened by Hitler's bombs, did this little building survive? Well, I'm in a position, ladies and gentlemen, to tell you exactly why. The ironmongers had a very clever idea, because as the City of London Fire Brigade returned every evening exhausted after fighting the fires, they were invited into the ironmongers' hall and were given rounds of sandwiches and cups of tea. And so when the ironmongers' hall was hit, they put out the fire. the City of London tried to compulsorily purchase this building, which had survived Hitler's bombs and were defeated by the ironmongers, and so the museum had to be built around it. The brief which was drawn up for the museum was drawn up with this problem site in mind. And I'm just going to read it for you, because it's very useful, this. This is almost a manifesto for the reticent type of modernist architecture that I've been talking about. So this is how the brief started. The architectural treatment of the exterior should evolve not only from a happy relationship with the existing and projected surrounding buildings, but also from the requirements of the interior of the museum. In other words, it was never intended to be an aggressive architectural statement. The brief demanded a comprehensible and untiring circulation plan, with the objects seen in an attractive but unassertive surrounding. It went on to explain that museums are too often associated with mental and physical fatigue. And to avoid this, the brief said, we believe it is right to provide some form of relief. For example, the main circulation route could be associated with a pleasantly arranged garden, like a cloistered walk, which of course is exactly what the museum got in the end. There was another problem, of course, with the site, because not only did they have to contend with the ironmongers' hall, they also had to contend with the Ministry of Transport, who insisted that it incorporated a roundabout in it. I mean, which museum anywhere in the world was forced to incorporate a roundabout? Well, there we are. It did. Nearly 10 years after Powell and Moyer were originally appointed, work began on the site in 1971, and it was eventually opened by the Queen in 1976. The museum cost £7 million. And it was part of a much bigger conception of how this part of the city ought to work. We only now have one of these towers, Bastion House, surviving. But some of you may remember what London Wall was designed to be like. It was designed to be like a series of dominoes standing up with these huge towers on both sides of the road. It was an incredibly bold structure. The pedestrians were not intended to go at road level. They were intended to be lifted up and to walk around in these pleasant walkways well away from the traffic. The Museum of London, I think, epitomises in many, many ways the modernist utopia that was being constructed in our cities. Now, I fear the fundamental issue that we have to face is that people have never warmed to the assertive breed of modernist architecture. Some people have never warmed to modernist architecture at all. And the Barbican, where we are this evening, and when you go home, you walk through it, is this very interesting mix, I think, of assertiveness and reticence. There are these reticent parts, which we're in now, and there are undoubtedly, when you look at those big concrete towers, some incredibly assertive parts. The Museum of London, despite its very odd design history and its very odd layout, is a reticent building. I don't think many people think the Museum of London is beautiful, but I equally think that few people actually hate it. But the same, I think, cannot be said for the South Bank Centre, which I think a lot of people do hate. But this very day, no one can say these lectures aren't topical, this very day, this has been published in your newspaper. As you pick up a tattered old copy of The Standard, which inevitably will be blowing down the street everywhere, because they get everywhere these days since it's been free, you will see this very image. This is the South Bank Centre's solution to deal with the with this assertive modernist building. I think this design is absolutely fascinating because it is desperately trying to soften the assertiveness. Look, they're going to put grass all over the top of this, as far as I can see, to try and soften it. And these big glass boxes to try and reduce the assertiveness. And trees to try, presumably, and trip up the skateboarders who go underneath. I think what is happening in the South Bank is of great interest, and we should watch it with interest, because it is all a part of trying to get away from a building which I fear is not loved by very many people at all. And this, I think, example brings me to the nub of the issue this evening. I would argue that people didn't like modernism very much before the Second World War, and after the Second World War, they liked it even less. But it did coincide with the post-war austerity programme, and it was really the only style in which people could afford to build. And I think this is a very important point. The economics of modernism is fundamental to understanding it. If it hadn't been, I think, for the war, modernism, I think, would have been much more of a brief fad in the 1920s and 30s. But what the war caused was a complete aesthetic divorce between architects and the public. And I think that that divorce has still not been entirely mended. And this is a very interesting phenomenon. It's a very interesting phenomenon in the entire history of English architecture. Because previous styles had been brought down by the sneers of connoisseurs, modernism was killed by the common man. People wanted beauty. They wanted ornament. They wanted colour. They wanted buildings that fitted in. They wanted traditional materials. But in providing those things, after the Second World War, the architects failed them. I went last year to the award ceremony of the Royal Institute of British Architects, a gold medal given to David Chipperfield. David Chipperfield is an architect who, I think, interestingly, has also built much of his reputation in designing museums. I show you here the lovely building, actually, the Rowing and River Museum at Henley-upon-Thames. David Chipperfield stood up and accepted his medal and gave a speech in which he said that he saw a dysfunctionality between the architectural profession and public opinion, and that he thought that architects were often seen as a sort of nurse pouring medicine down an unwilling client's throat. Sadly, this observation has been all too often true. But I don't want to end this series of lectures on a depressing note. For thanks to the efforts of some very good and some very sensitive architects, I think we are seeing again a happier relationship between designer and the public. And while these things, while there are still things going up which I personally deeply regret, there are also buildings like John McCaslin's sublime addition to King's Cross Station, which I think can find universal admiration. Thank you very much.